The Kalb Report is funded by a grant from the Ethics and Excellence in Journalism Foundation. From the National Press Club in Washington, D.C., this is the Kalb Report with Marvin Kalb.
Hello, and welcome to the National Press Club and to another edition of the Kalb Report. I'm Marvin Kalb, and our topic tonight, Democracy in Action, the Presidential Debates of 2016. With a few exceptions during the height of the Vietnam War, we have had these televised presidential debates since 1960, and they've always added to our understanding of the candidates and their policies. Perhaps not as much as we would have liked, but enough to be put on a must-see list during any presidential campaign. This last one in 2016 was special in many ways, and we shall discuss the presidential debates of 2016 with two of the moderators and the two co-chairs of the Commission on Presidential Debates. First, the moderators, Martha Raddatz, who is chief global affairs correspondent for ABC News, where she's been for 20 years. Earlier, she worked for NPR. This year, she co-moderated the second presidential debate. 4 years ago, she moderated the vice presidential debate. The other moderator, Chris Wallace of Fox News, where he has been for the last 13 years after long stints with ABC News and NBC News. In fact, Chris has been a broadcaster for 50 years, following a distinguished family tradition. The two co-chairs of the commission are first Frank Fahrenkopf, who helped set up the debate commission in 1986, working then with the Democrat Paul Kirk. He is a Washington lawyer who was president of the American Gaming Association. The other co-chair, the Democrat, is Mike McCurry, a communications specialist and professor of public theology at Wesley Theological Seminary here in Washington, D.C. He was also a spokesman at the White House and the State Department under President Bill Clinton. Martha, we start with you. The two candidates in the 2016 race, Donald Trump and Hillary Clinton, were not your run-of-the-mill candidates. They were, in their way, very special. So I'm asking you, how did that specialness affect the way in which you prepared for the debate?
Well, I think whenever you prepare for a debate, you approach it. I approached it in the same way I approached the vice presidential debate. First of all, it is the Super Bowl of debates, without question. I mean, we'd done some primary debates. All the networks had done primary debates. But when you go into a general election debate and the candidates, as you said, are special, I do think you have to think about that. You have to think about how you'll ask a question. But that's the same thing I would have done no matter who the candidates
Nothing
were.
Nothing special in the preparation?
The special part of the preparation is you prepare for that candidate. You look at that candidate over the campaign, you look at both candidates over the campaign, you want to ask questions in a way that you think will get answers. I mean, it was a town hall debate, so we looked at the questions that the people were presenting to them and decided amongst ourselves and with Anderson Cooper, which ones would be best for the candidates. And I don't mean, I'm going to trick you up with this or I'm going to trick you up with that. But there are questions that the audience had for, or the town hall members had for particular candidates, and we could follow up. Now you, and I'm sure Chris does the same thing. When you follow up and when you think you might get a certain kind of question, you're going to follow up in a way that you hope you get even more of an answer, or okay. An answer, period.
Chris, you seemed, at least in my judgment, very surprised by Donald Trump's response to your question about respecting the end result of the election. And that was a very special moment, and I'm wondering what your feelings were at that time. Were you prepared for his answer? What?
Well, I didn't know what his answer was going to be, but I thought it was a great question because whatever he answered, I knew it was going to make news. It was very much out there. His vice president had said, yes, of course, he'll respect the results. And his daughter that day had said he was going to respect the results. But as we've learned, until Donald Trump says it, it doesn't matter what anybody else says. And so when I asked the question, and he, you know, here, and Martha's exactly right. There are a lot of debates, but the general election debates are different, and they're just a level of seriousness. There's a level of attention, audience. You know, you were saying what was different about these debates. Donald Trump was different about these debates, and because of Donald Trump, I think, the audiences were enormous. The first debate was the most watched first debate ever. Ours was the most watched third debate ever. So I knew that whatever he said, it was going to be a big deal. When he said it, even though I was certainly prepared for it, I was still kind of shocked in the moment. Here was a, you know, less than 3 weeks, 20 days before the election, here is a presidential candidate saying, I'll have to think about it, about accepting the results of the election. And then purely ad-libbed, I just thought, I want to put this in historical perspective, that there is a long tradition of the peaceful transfer of power. There's a long tradition. We grow up, we know about what Nixon did in the 1960 race or what Gore did in 2000 after the recount in the Supreme Court ruling, that was a big deal, and I wanted to put it in historical perspective. And then, of course, he then said, I'll keep you in suspense.
Well, he did. Frank Fahrenkopf, you've been a co-chair of the commission since it was started in the late 1980s. In your judgment, what makes a good moderator?
The hardest job that we have on the commission is determining who the moderators are going to be. In my experience, and we have done 30 now, presidential and vice presidential debates since the commission was created. And the hardest thing is to who you're going to pick for moderators. You must think about diversity. We examine as much as we can the work product of the would-be moderators to see whether or not this is a person who has not gone far left or right with regard to any particular candidate, so they can't be a fair moderator in asking of questions. And we spent a lot of time on it. It's got to be something, and there was a great deal of debate before these debates as to what the job of Martha and Chris and Ann Anderson, et cetera, were going to be with regard to, quote, fact-checking. And, you know, there were people who wanted us to have a trailer along the bottom of the television tube saying, well, what they said was wrong or right. Our view was that's not the job of the moderator. The moderator is to facilitate the discussion and get out of the way. If one of the candidates says something that's wrong, it's a debate. The other candidate is supposed to be the one who corrects them.
Well, now, so you sent ground rules for what it is that they do?
No, we sent no ground rules.
Well, that's what you seem to be saying.
No, we're just indicating when people ask us what you just asked me.
What
we're looking at in a debate, that's what we're looking at. Someone who can take that role and do the job.
Okay. Mike, in selecting moderators, do you have to clear your selections with the presidential candidates?
No.
And has there ever been a time when a candidate has said, I don't particularly like that reporter, I don't want to go on with him?
In the past, maybe yes, and Frank can tell you the history, but not in the last two or three cycles.
In 1984, I think it was, that's before the commission started, the League of Women Voters was doing, and the League of Women Voters gave to the two campaigns the veto right, and I believe it was over 90 reporters were either nixed or zeroed out as moderators or panelists, because then there was a moderator along with a panel of reporters.
What were the marching orders, and this is for both of you, what were the marching orders that you gave to these two moderators?
Be yourself, ask good questions, that was it. We don't know what the questions are going to be, we don't ask them what the questions are going to be, we trust their journalistic integrity, and they rewarded us, particularly these two.
Frank, can I just pick up on?
I mean, the two that we picked here, pretty good examples of why we do the work the way we do it. We pick qualified, intelligent journalists who are going to ask very, very good questions. We do get lobbied by a lot of different people. We work to put on these debates.
Lobbied by whom?
Mostly the networks, because we work in collaboration with
the
five.
And the networks would like to push their anchor.
Correct. There are five networks that we collaborate with who are part of the network pool, and they are all very aggressive in pushing for their favored correspondents. And we sometimes have examples of where we don't necessarily follow what we hear from those networks.
Marvin, I just wanted to give you a sense of how little marching orders there are. So Janet Brown, the executive director, calls me up, and it's a little bit like becoming a made man in the mafia. She almost reads like a formal script.
What Chris meant to say was,
no, that's about what it is. And it's like, you know, do you accept? And it's quite formal and quite moving, actually, when you get that phone call. And she said, now, you're going to get to ask all the questions. We don't want you to share them with us, the commission. We don't want you to share them with either campaign. That was obvious. And she said, about a week before the debate, you're going to have to come up with six topics. And the six topics that we will tell the campaigns, these are the six topics, six segments, immigration or foreign policy, whatever. And I said, well, who decides those? And she said, you do. And I went, whoa.
Now, wait a minute. You didn't decide the six.
I did decide them. The point is that she said, you're going to, a week ahead of time, you tell the campaign, what are the six topics that will be in the debate? Like, mine were Supreme Court, economy, immigration, on and on.
Right.
But when I said, who decides what my six topics are going to be, she said, you do. And it's completely left up to you.
And those were publicly announced, Marvin. That's important to know that they were.
Right.
I mean, there really is just a purity to the process. When you get that call, you're on your own. You hit the books. And then
what happened in your relationship with the network? I mean, Mike was talking before about network big shots wanting to push certain anchors. What kind of relationship did you have?
I'm not involved in that. No, my network could not have been better at backing me at every step of the way. And not only that, but hey, I need time to do this. And I think the message to me was always, at some point when you want, you know, off World News or off Good Morning America and you're coming up against the debate, just tell us. They gave me time to prepare. They helped me prepare.
What do you mean they gave you time? In other words, you didn't have to do your regular assignment.
Your big assignment was this. Yes, my big assignment became this.
Did you have people helping you with the research?
You bet. I had a research team. Remember, we're the town hall again. Did they know the follow-ups, that if we got this question, this is how I'd follow up? We worked on that for weeks.
Okay. Tell me what, for both of you now, what was the most gratifying part? You've sort of touched on it already. The most gratifying part of being selected for this job, but also the most challenging. Chris.
Well, I think, as I say, it is an enormous statement of trust on the part of the commission. And I hope in the course of this we'll talk a little bit about the commission, because I think it's really a national treasure. I remember in 1980 and 1984 when I was covering Reagan, and the debates were basically decided by the campaigns. And Jim Baker for the Reagan campaign, and Jim Johnson, for instance, for the Mondale campaign, or Hamilton Jordan for the Carter campaign, they would get together and they would negotiate. I mean, they would negotiate everything. By this time, and I think Frank and Mike would say this, the power of the commission has grown over the years so that they now dictate. They say, we're going to have the debate in Las Vegas on this date, and it'll be this kind of a debate, you know, town hall or one-on-one, and so-and-so is going to be the moderator. And they dictate it, and because of that, it's taken out of politics, and an independent body which is not concerned about electing either of them as president.
What was the most challenging part?
The most challenging thing for me was, the good news was I'm getting a debate. The bad news, and I love the way Frank said it, he'd be a great salesman because he made this sound like it was a good thing. He said, you're batting cleanup, Chris. And I said, what's that mean? He said, you're doing the last debate. Well, that sounds good, but this was about September 3rd, and the last debate was October 19th, which meant that I had a month and a half to stew about this. It was horrible.
And prepare.
It was horrible. My wife is in the front row. She will tell you how horrible it was. And the funny thing is, basically, you know, you want to immediately get to work and prepare. You can't prepare. I had to wait till their debate was over on October 9th. And I wanted to see what had been asked, what the campaign was, what the issues were, what the scandals were. And it was only in those last 10 days that I prepared.
Martha, the most challenging moment for you was what?
I would say the most challenging moment for me was Friday evening after the Access Hollywood tapes were released. And we had already prepared for the debate, which was Sunday. And we really had to reconfigure everything and think about what our responsibility was because of that, how we would deal with that between our teams. And again, it was a town hall. We didn't know whether people would be really asking about that or whether they'd want to ask about that in a national debate. And I would say the most gratifying is you are, the moment you get that call, you are part of history. Mm-hmm. You are part of presidential history. And it is a profound moment. And you know you have a huge responsibility. And part of that responsibility is what we've talked about here, too, that it's not about you, that you facilitate that conversation. You certainly want answers, and I know both Chris and I tried very hard to get answers, and I think we did a pretty good job of that. But it is a profound sense of responsibility and an honor. And I really don't say that lightly at all. It is an honor to do these debates.
Have you ever interviewed a presidential candidate like Donald Trump?
No.
Do you think
I think everybody in the press would probably answer that the same way.
No, I understand. But as you were approaching your moment that Sunday, and you hadn't ever interviewed anybody like him, you couldn't really anticipate what his response was going to be. He was pretty much a loose cannon.
No. You couldn't. You absolutely couldn't.
Right.
I'd done a primary debate with him, and I think we were down to maybe 7 Republican candidates at that point. I'd obviously had the advantage of watching the debate with Lester Holt, so you had a little clue of how he might handle it. And Lester had the most challenging being the very first and not knowing how the debate would proceed. So I you look at that. I mean, I'd done an interview with Donald Trump before, so I knew in that sense. But again, it's whatever you think or how unusual a candidate he was, you do it the same way. You study, you figure out, and try to figure out how they will answer it. It might just be a little more difficult with him.
Now, we talked about this a moment ago. I think, Chris, you mentioned it, that the first debate attracted 84 million people, and probably 100 million if you were to throw in...
You throw in C-SPAN, which I heard was about 15. That got you up to 99, and that did not count people who were on their computers or streaming on their iPads and so forth.
Now,
so it was well over 100 million.
I mean, I have to say, that sounds absolutely, wow.
Yeah, I thought so.
But at the same time, yeah. No, I thought you would. But what I'm trying to get at here is that we have heard from the moderators what an awesome responsibility it is. No question about that. And the idea of interviewing somebody who's going to be president, big deal. And you have all of these people out there, and it strikes me that it could be seen as mass entertainment as opposed to a very large classroom of civics. Mass entertainment, and when you have that many people and that many television thises and thatses, you're in entertainment, aren't you? I mean, you guys are putting together the best show that you could.
Marvin, this is the Kalb Report. How would you do it differently?
Oh, if you guys did it as well as we do.
Don't give
serious question
lines, please.
Here. How do you prepare a show? Because that's what you did.
No, that's not true.
Oh, it is?
Our job is to take the leading candidates for President of the United States.
With a realistic chance of victory.
Who have got a chance to be elected president, and we have a measure of that, and there's some controversy about that if you want to get into that. And give them a place where they can present their best argument about why they ought to be President of the United States. I mean, what more do you want us to do than to present good moderators who ask good questions and let the candidates do whatever they want to do. We saw what they did in 2016. Can I say I thought that was the most substantive, serious, sober discussion about the future of the country I've ever heard? No. But that's what the two candidates gave us. That's what we, the people, have
to do. I want to make a dichotomy, which I think is so important, which we really felt in this series of debates. I felt that one of the difficulties we had, and I don't remember Martha having to deal with it, but Chris had to deal with it, and Lester did, that we had audience participation in this. Where we, in the past, we really, you know, we go out and tell the audience, this is different. This is not the primary debates, where I felt sometimes watching the primary debates that the networks were holding up applause signs and things of that nature, because it got wild and it's got woolly. Our debates have always been that we have a White House feed that goes out. We have no interruptions. There are no commercials. The networks take what we put out. We go for 90 minutes. We hopefully think that the candidates are going to answer smart questions asked by moderators. But you know, it's not only the answers, Martin. One of the things I've done 30 of them since the beginning. And one of the things I learned, someone said to me once, what have you come out of? You've done 30 of these things. What's the thing that gets you? And the thing that I came up with, and which was the challenge, I think, in this series of debates, is I have learned that the American people, after doing 30 of these, don't necessarily elect and vote for the smartest person. They want to like their president. That was a challenge here when you had both candidates with negative approval ratings by the American people. And that's what made this, I think, a little more dynamic than it has been in the past. But, you know, we got, Mike and I both got, and Janet and the other members of the commission said, you should have had a button where you, Chris, or you, Martha, or the other moderators could shut off the microphone of the other person. But you know, you learn a lot about a human being when they're on that stage, if they're interrupting, if they're not being courteous. So you're learning a lot about character. So it's not just the answer to the question from a substantive standpoint or an educational standpoint, but you're seeing a person and you're making judgment on that person.
Absolutely. To the moderators, both Jim Lehrer, who did many, many debates and did them so very well.
12.
Says, 12 of them. Mm-hmm. Says the best approach is just ask your question, don't fact check, let the candidate say what he or she wants to say, and then move on. Do you buy that?
I had lunch with Jim before my debate, and then I talked to him about 2 or 3 days before the debate, because if a guy's done 12 debates, he's got to have pretty good advice. Not entirely, I don't agree with that, and I don't think that he necessarily would agree with that either, even if he said it. And in the sense that this, I mean, I'll give you an example. One of the hardest things, the way the debates were structured, each segment, I'm doing a segment on immigration, I'm going to ask a single question to both candidates, and Clinton's going to get, whoever's turn to go first is going to get 2 minutes to answer, uninterrupted, and sometimes that meant, Mr. Trump, it's her 2 minutes, he's going to get 2 minutes to answer, and then there's 10 minutes for a free-flow conversation. Well, you're necessarily going to interrupt because you're not going to let one person go for 10 minutes. And there were times when you have to interrupt. I mean, I'll give you a perfect example. And one of the more difficult kind of judgment calls you have to make as a moderator, I was asking about the controversies that they both faced about emails and with him about women making allegations. And I wanted to ask about the Clinton Foundation. And so I asked Secretary Clinton, you know, Mr. Trump says that you've blurred the lines between public and private and that this is pay to play. And she says, Chris, thanks so much. You know, that's all been investigated. It's not been proven. But I'd love to talk about the Clinton Foundation. And I'm thinking, oh, boy, because now here she goes, and she's going to talk about all the legitimately good works they do all over the world, which is interesting, but not really the question that I asked. But it's not the easiest thing in the world to say to the former Secretary of State, I don't want to hear about what you're doing for poor children in Africa. I want you to talk about the scandal. But that's what you have to do as a moderator. So sometimes you can't just let them go on.
No, you can't let them go on, but that's different from saying what they're saying is wrong. If you know, Martha, I'll throw it at you, the obvious question. If you know that the candidate is saying something that is inaccurate, it is a lie, it is wrong, is it your responsibility as a moderator to tell the American people what you just heard is wrong?
I don't think that's my responsibility to say what you just heard is wrong. I think one of the ways I approach it is, here are your words, or, I mean, it's what Frank said. Mr. Trump, do you have anything to say about what Secretary Clinton just said? And if I think at one point on the Iraq, on public pronouncements of being against the Iraq war, that had been litigated so many times through the debates and through the news media. I think at one point when he said that again during the debate that I said something like, I know critics say otherwise, period. And then it is the responsibility of the others. Do I think I should just sit back? I mean, if they say to me, you know, a no-fly zone is really easy to do, I might, with some expertise, say, actually, what so-and-so says about a no-fly zone is that it would take 10,000 troops. It's not me debating Donald Trump or Hillary Clinton. It is me trying to get answers from the candidates and let the other debate. Now, and again, am I prepared with things to come back at them and say, but, you know, you said on July 19th this. I mean, it's the same thing you do on our Sunday shows. You want to come back and have a follow-up that's tough, but it is not my job to say you're wrong about that. It is my job to find perhaps some evidence where they've said something else or to let the other candidate.
But there was something very distinctive about these debates and about the entire campaign. And Chris said before, the essential element in it was Donald Trump. He was the one. If it were not for Donald Trump, you wouldn't have had these astronomical ratings. It simply wouldn't have been
I
there.
Agree.
Yeah,
and so what I'm trying to get at, what I'm trying to get at here, and we're going to get into more detail on this in a little bit, but the whole idea of a candidate saying something that is undeniably a lie, if you don't feel it's your responsibility to challenge,
but
then the
lie
stays there.
But I'm not saying don't challenge. I'm just saying the way you worded that, Marvin, you know, you are wrong about that. I don't think that's the way to do it. I think if you have something to challenge, then you shouldn't have said it. that you have follow-ups, you have material, you have stuff you can talk about with that candidate and bring it up to the other candidate. They're debating. You can make that conversation.
Can I also add a point that seems not to be given as much relevance as it should? The other person on that stage told untruths as well. It wasn't like it was just Donald Trump who told whoppers. So did Hillary Clinton. And you get into a slippery slope, Marvin. If you start to say, well, I'm going to fact check and say what Donald Trump said here is wrong, do you have an obligation then to do to Hillary
Absolutely.
Clinton? Well then, but if you're going to do it on this level, you know, the big, what you consider an outrageous whopper, well, how about the kind of medium whopper? Or the, I mean, I don't want to sound like Burger King here, but, but you know, in other words, you then run into, at what level do I intervene and what level do I not intervene? And at a certain point, it stops being a debate between the two presidential candidates.
That's the point.
Hang on just a minute. I want to take a moment now.
We've got to do this. You should do a debate.
I want to take a moment here now to remind our radio, television, and web audiences that this is the Kalb Report. I'm Marvin Kalb, and I'm discussing the 2016 presidential debates with Martha Raddatz of ABC, Chris Wallace of Fox News, and Mike McCurry and Frank Fahrenkopf, the co-chairs of the Commission on Presidential Debates. Now, I'm picking up a point which has sort of been lurking in the underbrush here, to discuss a relatively new phenomenon in our public discourse. It's called post-truth. The Oxford dictionaries define post-truth as, here I'm quoting, relating to or denoting circumstances in which objective facts are less influential in shaping public opinion than appeals to emotion and personal belief, unquote. Chris, journalists are supposed to be in the truth business. We tell the truth as best we know it. How did we suddenly get into this post-truth business?
I don't know that we're suddenly in it. I mean, there have always been appeals to emotion. I mean, as Frank said, an awful lot of particularly in politics, is a kind of gut, visceral reaction. Ronald Reagan won the debate in 1980 by saying, there you go again. It wasn't an untruth, but, well, actually, it kind of was. But my point is that it was an appeal to emotion. It was an appeal to, I'm a reasonable guy, and you can trust me to be president, and that made a difference.
He was cracking a joke.
No, I don't think so. I think he was making a comment.
Where's the truth in that? You know, that's the kind of thing when you talk about fact-checking. There are different views of this.
I'm trying to get at something that's a little more serious than that. The post-truth phenomenon is a very important thing that does affect our politics. I think it does affect our journalism. It does suggest that if you play with things in a skillful way, you can win over a public without even laying your cards on the table. You don't have to do that because you have somehow or another gone beyond the responsibility of just laying out the truth as best you know it. Do you feel, maybe you don't at all, but Frank, do you feel that there is any danger that we may be approaching a post-truth world?
It's the first time I've ever heard of post-truth, but I'm glad you educated me tonight. I look at this differently, Marvin, than what is the responsibility of Chris or Martha doing their Sunday shows where they're interviewing candidates. And it's one-on-one, and Chris is asking a question, or Martha is, and they give an answer that is post-truth or is working with the facts in such a way. Then I view their job as moderators they're moderating their own show, one-on-one, to correct and go after them and say, wait a minute, you said this last week, well, that's really not true. The debates are different. In my view, and I won't speak for Mike, he can speak for himself, the debates are different. A debate is a debate. You want to try it. The reason that we changed the format 4 years ago and got away from this, you ask a question to candidate A, and they have 2 minutes to answer, and then candidate B has 1 minute to respond, candidate A gets 30 seconds, and then you move on. We divided it in this, Chris, these six segments, where we can get down and drill down and get facts. But it's not the job, in our view, of that moderator to do what they would do on their Sunday shows, one-on-one with the candidate. I think that's a vast difference. And that's the point I'm trying to make, which is a little different than where you're going.
And the questions are different, too. I mean, when you sit around in those research teams, we often say this is not an interview. This is a debate. The questions are going to be a different way that you approach those candidates. Mm-hmm.
So among the four of you here, the concept of post-truth is in no way a disturbing phenomenon.
I think politicians have been doing that for years.
Why, I don't think this
is something new. Okay. I don't think there's anything new. If you're talking about a politician taking a set of facts and trying to come out with a approach to those facts or a result of those facts that you don't agree with or that other people don't agree with, I mean, that's part of politics.
It doesn't, Mike, you want to
say
something.
Maybe I don't understand what you mean by
post-truth. What, Mike, go ahead.
I think your question is about the crisis that exists in journalism, the fact that there is no economically viable model to support the kind of excellent journalism that we've been accustomed to for a long time. And I think the challenge to journalists, I'm not a journalist, I thought about being one earlier in my career, is to how do you take truth. Post-truth is just a silly comment, a silly phrase. There is truth that journalists have to uncover and report and aggressively go after. And they have to do it with creativity and inspiration, and they have to work hard to make it compelling for the audiences that need to get the truth. Mm-hmm. And the failure of journalists to do that is why we are in this quandary and why we have allowed content to go off to fake news and social media and other places. It is the responsibility of our established, respectable, verifiable, accurate news organizations that we depend on as Americans to do a better job. That's what we need.
Okay, based totally of what Mike just said, how do you guys both feel about the quality of the journalism, not individually, that you're producing, but the industry itself at this point? And how well do you think it did in the coverage of the 2016 campaign?
Chris?
I don't think that the fact-checking was the big problem. I think we did a lot of that, and I think that to the degree that people cared, that the record was set straight on things that all of the candidates said, but I'll focus particularly on Hillary, Clinton, and Donald Trump. I think, generally speaking, people knew the truth or falsity of what they were saying. The thing that bothered me the most, particularly during the primaries, was the overcoverage of Donald Trump's rallies. And that was, I think, a business decision. And I'm talking particularly now about cable news, and frankly, we were not the worst offenders, that if Donald Trump was giving a rally and you didn't have him on and your competitor did have him on, that you were going to lose eyeballs to your competitor. And so it was not only that they would carry the rallies, but we all know that they would show the podium before the rally for 45 minutes and say, waiting for the Donald Trump rally. I know that just drove the other campaigns in the primaries nuts. That was, I think, a terrible mistake, and we shouldn't have done it. I think there should have been, look, with 17 candidates, you're not going to cover everybody the same, and there obviously were candidates that were more viable than other candidates, and we always do that kind of winnowing process. But I think that the overcoverage of Trump, because he was good for business, I mean, money, bottom line, was a mistake. But having said that, people say, and I think they get it wrong, they say, we were trying to push Trump. No, we weren't leading public opinion, we were following public opinion, and he was driving ratings, and so we, and fortunately I didn't have to make that decision, caved to it.
Martha, you agree with that?
Well, I think that we as journalists have to take a hard look at 2016. I think absolutely we want to move on. We just want to cover the administration. But I do think we have to be self-reflective of things exactly like Chris is talking about and how we covered it and how we're fair. I think that when you're in the moment and you're in a campaign that is one of the most unusual in history, you adjust as you go along. I think there was some very, very good journalism. And people sort of caught up with what was happening and how we approached it.
Where was the very, very good journalism?
Well, I
think
the
Martha Raddatz show on ABC.
Yeah,
no,
exactly.
I'm sure that's true.
And Chris Wallace. I mean, I think the Post did a lot of great journalism.
I was going to say, how about the New York Times breaking the fact that Hillary Clinton had a private email system in March of 2015?
New York Times.
Yes. Yeah, that people forget about. I mean, that was a huge breaking story, and that drove campaign coverage.
Or the Washington Post and David Fahrenkopf on Trump and the charities. I mean, no, there was a lot of good journalism done.
Another point. The
Can
polls.
I interrupt for just a minute? I think you really have to give Donald Trump a tremendous amount of credit for changing maybe journalism in the future.
Well, that's a very interesting thing.
Is that where
you're
going?
Spell that out for me.
Well, what I mean is, when has there been a candidate who would get up in the morning and call Morning Joe or CBS Morning News and say, hey, if you want, I'll come.
Now, is that a good thing for journalists?
You're a journalist. You make that decision.
No, I've made the decision for myself.
Yeah.
But do you think it's good journalism?
I don't know. I'm not a journalist.
But you just made the point that we have to be what to him? What did he do to journalism?
No, I'm saying what he did to you was this, and it had maybe to do with the profit margin that you were talking about. If you're a morning show and you don't have to go through what you normally do in the old days with a candidate, as you know, you have to go through press secretaries and so forth. It takes forever to schedule people to be on the shows. And you'd get that call and say, yeah, I'll go on and interview, earn media. I mean, it was incredible.
And let us say that he made that call to Fox or ABC or anybody. Yeah. And he had absolutely nothing to say. It was just a repeat of what he had said before, except he was utterly outrageous in what he said.
They would put him on.
But they did put him on.
They put him on.
Yes. Well, no, and you think this is a good thing?
Not everybody put him on. One Sunday show, you demanded to do call-ins.
Show up in person.
Right. That's right. And modesty prevents me from saying what show it was.
No, no. That's a good deal. That's a good deal. That's fascinating. Mike, do you buy that analysis of the media and the relationship with Trump?
My role at the White House was to be kind of a human pinata for the press corps, to get beat up.
That's the bad thing.
Day in and day out.
Yeah.
That's skin cancer from California growing up. But it seems to me that, and I like the fact that Donald Trump made himself accessible and called into shows. But I also think that the scrutiny and accountability that he needed to have from journalists who would then have that opportunity to talk to him should have been a little more aggressive, more akin to what I was familiar with at the White House.
I think they were pretty aggressive.
Did anyone ask him,
oh, by the way, are you going to try to upset and unroll everything that we've done in Asia for the last 25 years and give Taiwan new promise?
We were asking about it. He wasn't on this week, but I was asking Kellyanne Conway about it. And I know my competitors were asking Mike Pence and Reince Priebus about it. But I mean, he got hammered during the campaign for his opening statements about, immigrants crossing the border and Mexicans being rapists and criminals, or saying that John McCain, I mean, it wasn't for lack of coverage, Marvin.
No, but the point, thank you for raising that, because in the past week, his spokesman, including Ms. Conway, was trying to explain the way in which he used words and the way in which he would present ideas. And what she was saying, in effect, is that he was saying these things, but the American people should not have really taken that seriously. It's just the mood he was striking. You can't go with the fact, she said. You've got to go with the mood.
Well, she can say anything she wants.
Well, of course.
Well, Mike McCurry said all kinds of stuff for Clinton. But that's her spin on it. But that we didn't take it that way. We didn't say, well, he said that, but that's just Donald, and we're not going to treat it seriously.
Hillary Clinton didn't hold a press conference for how long? It was months.
250 days.
Yeah, something like 250.
Here's a guy saying, "I'm available."
And Marvin, you talk about you during a debate, and is it difficult to ask questions to Donald Trump? It's also difficult to ask questions to someone who's just giving you talking points. I mean, you have to have a different approach with that as well. And Secretary Clinton's very good at those talking points, and you try to get her back to something that will be a meaningful answer as well.
Yeah. No, I totally agree. Let me ask the two of you, if the commission, in its wisdom, were to ask you to come back in 4 years and be moderators again, what would you have learned from the 2016 experience that could be profitably put into a 2020 debate environment? Chris?
I'd ask to do the first debate so I didn't have to stew over it for 6 weeks.
Hey, do you really think that, or do you think that you benefited from being
I actually do think I benefited. It took about 8 inches of colon out of me, but I did benefit.
I think Lester Holt had a tougher assignment than you had, because you could actually build on the record that had come, and he was the first moderator of the first debate.
And by the way, Chris, I'm just going to tell you, when we would sit and talk about topics, if there was one we didn't like, we'll say, "Well, just Chris will have
well,
to
funny thing,
we'll just leave that for Chris."
I had some topics, and very near the end of the debate, one of them you guys asked, and I went, "Damn it!" Now, you know, because I was hoping that there'd be some clear road for me in the debate.
Not to shortchange Marvin here, but you know, one thing I've been asked a lot is, why did we not have a substantive discussion about global climate change or some of the issues that were sort of left off the table, which actually came to you then because you had the chance at the last debate to add more substance in. And I've gotten that question a lot, so I'm just asking both of you. Could have come up in the town hall.
Yes.
Arguably, one of the
because Chris was going to ask about it. We just assumed Chris was going to.
You know,
it didn't come up in the 2012 debate,
and it didn't come up in the 2016 debate. It's arguably one of the most important things we have to think about.
When you asked public opinion polling, it really wasn't.
Well,
I'm just telling you.
It matters.
Of course, it matters.
He's getting
but
all
not
these
to the
people
American
are calling
people.
Him off his back, so he's coming to us. Obviously a really important topic.
Yes.
I will tell you one thing about our debate. There were topics that we hoped to get to, But because of what happened on that Friday, we probably lost a lot of time. For
another one for me is poverty and hunger and homelessness in this country. No question about that.
Absolutely, things like that we thought would come up in that town hall debate, or that you can guide the conversation in that way.
Yeah, but were you waiting for the candidates to raise that, or did you think you had a responsibility to put those questions?
Well, I think, you know, like all of us, we sit down and I had a town hall debate, so I'm pretty dependent.
Right, so you're relying on
people,
the people.
But I mean, I can go back to 2012, and it's what Chris did too, that you have topics that you read about, that you hear covered every day, that people talk about, that people send you things that you see on social media now, and see how important those are. I mean, we really did try to vet topics and what was important, and if they're talking about it on social media, is there somebody behind that generating more social media so we'll talk about it? I mean, I think you have to be very careful in choosing those topics.
But my point back would be the candidates are going to talk about the issues that they think the broad swath of the middle income average taxpayer cares about. So those who are marginalized in our country need to have someone who will voice their concerns in these debates. And I think that is a role that the moderators need to play.
Yeah, but what is that suggesting? What is the point of what you have just asked?
That we need questions that come from the moderators that get at something.
Yeah, but
other
these
than
are smart moderators, and all of the others were too.
Well, gets at something other.
Why?
Other than what is the top five issues that the polls tell us that
people care.
But
we do try to get beyond those, Mike. I mean, we do. And
no, I know. I just. It's frustrating to me that we did not. These are really important issues, and we never get into those.
But in my debate, by the time I got to my debate, the Supreme Court had never been asked. They talked about it very briefly.
Correct.
Had
That's
never
a
been
very
asked.
Good point. Very good point.
Immigration had never been asked. Debt and entitlements had never been asked.
The wall had never
So if you got to do those three, I thought, because they had never been asked. You got to do something on the economy. You have to do something on foreign policy. And then I had to have one, which was my National Enquirer segment, which was about stuff.
Yeah.
But I did put it 45 minutes into the debate.
It's a good evidence, Marvin, that we do not dictate the content. We, on the commission, leave it to the moderators. It's to the moderators' best judgment what they need to ask. And it's also then incumbent upon the candidates to engage in the subjects that they think are most important. Now, they will follow whatever their political people tell them, or who is the persuadable voter, what do you need to say, what do you need to get at, what is messages that you need to convey. I'm just trying to think about ways in which in these debates we can elevate those subjects that are truly important,
but
that
truly,
really matter.
Truly is subjective, Mike.
No, it isn't. Global climate change is not subjective, Frank, and neither is poverty and homelessness and hunger.
From the standpoint
One in
of
five children in this country are hungry.
They are. But the question of whether it's number one or number three or number five, that's another question.
Yes.
We've got a limited amount of time. We've got 90 minutes with a hell of a lot of subjects covered.
Right, but if Not we just follow say, what the pollsters say,
they didn't
we won't get
it.
To any of these other
Listen,
subjects.
Listen, these people have the toughest job in the world, to go out on that stage before 100 million people for 90 minutes and try not to screw up. And
which is what he said to me just before. He said, don't screw it up. Those were my comforting words of wisdom.
By the way, Frank and I rarely disagree on anything.
I don't disagree with you that those are important issues, but you only have so much time to get into all these
things. Okay, we have covered that point. Thank you, Mike, very much.
That was an excellent
Very
debate.
Well done.
Very, yes.
Very,
that was
very well done.
Whatever.
I want to talk about where journalism is today, and so I'm directing it at the two of you.
That sounds like
there are
nap
a lot
time.
Of people. There are a lot of people who feel that journalists are having a very difficult time now. There are economic reasons, financial reasons for that, but it's not just that. We brushed aside the post-truth idea a moment ago. Let that sit as one of the subjects, along with climate change, that we should have discussed. What I'm interested in now is this idea that if journalism has reached a point in our society where a lot of people, for whatever reason, don't believe what the journalist is saying,
they believe that the journalists are using facts that they don't recognize as fact. Whatever the explanation might be, it's reached a point where the language of journalism is inadequate to meet the responsibilities of journalism in a society under phenomenal change, and where the tweets and all of the modern means of communication seem to have overwhelmed so many of us. We're living with too much information, perhaps. And I'm wondering whether you, both of you now, think about questions of journalism's role these days, where it is, where it could be better. Is it being overwhelmed by this general suspicion of journalism? I remember in my time, and granted that's a bit, a couple of years ago, most of what we, not all of it by any means, but an awful lot of what we said was accepted, if not as truth, as an effort on the part of these reporters to get at the truth. I don't sense that now. And if I'm wrong, correct me. If I'm right, help me understand where we go.
Well, first of all, I think you have to divide what journalism is and what online hits are or what rumors on the internet are. I mean, that's a real problem. When you've got fake news or you've got social media that is throwing stuff out there that's not true, that's a real challenge. It's a challenge for our public. As far as journalism goes, I think, Marvin, there are people in journalism today who have not changed from the time you were a journalist. There are people who are fighting to get the truth, who will continue to do that every day. One of them sitting right here next to me. I certainly pride myself on trying to do that as
Absolutely.
Well in as objective way as possible. And the thing that was heartening here for me tonight is meeting all these young journalists
Absolutely.
In college all over the country who want to be like that journalist you talk about. But the social media element of this and a public who does not know the difference between a journalist and someone who just writes something or makes something up online is a real issue.
Let me talk. Well, do you remember Walter Cronkite? And on that show, a couple of times a week.
I have to ask you to cool it for one second.
Okay, cool it.
Okay.
Come back to me.
I will come back to you in just a sec, but I want to stick with this idea of the role of journalism
That's
in our society
going.
Today.
I'm responsive.
I'm going to give you your chance. The role has always been, it's a special role in a democracy, in a vibrant democracy. We are supposed to serve as a kind of watchdog on government officials, policy, all of that. We're always delighted to quote our founding fathers. We say that they placed the concept of freedom of the press right up there in the First Amendment of the Bill of Rights of the U.S. Constitution. And it was not an afterthought when they did that. It was fundamental. Thomas Jefferson once said famously that if he had a choice between government without newspapers or newspapers without a government, he would take the newspapers. What I hear, point to our journalists again, many colleagues, maybe not the two of you, but many I know, fear that a Trump administration may, in one way or another, cut back on freedom of the press. They also feel that many Americans are so distrustful of the media that they would raise no meaningful objections if the government attempted to crack down. Do you share these concerns? And I'm asking all of you, and I appeal to you, to give me no more than 30 seconds, and I want to start with Mike. Do you share those concerns?
About the future of journalism? I'm not sure your soliloquy there, what the question was. About the role of the press?
Well, I said, if you were listening,
I did.
That
I
there are a lot of people who are concerned that journalists may be losing their way or the people are not trusting them any longer.
Right. I think competition in journalism based on speed and how fast you break news is one of the real dangers. And we have to develop a new economic model for the journalistic economic enterprise that's based on substance, depth, thoroughness. and that would develop a whole different kind of journalism where people are not scrambling to try to report facts, which sometimes they get wrong, which jeopardizes the integrity of the journalistic enterprise, but goes back to substance. And that
30 seconds. Frank.
When I was talking about water contact, because I remember twice a week, I think it was twice a week, a gentleman, well-coiffed and beautifully dressed, would come out. His name was Eric Severide. And on CBS, underneath his...
commentary.
It said commentary. So you knew that it was his commentary and his opinion. It wasn't necessarily the news. And that's where the big change has been. Too many times now, reporters are reporting a story, and then they've got a tagline at the end, determine what it's going to be. I was a Republican state chairman before I was national chairman of the party, and my candidates were always complaining, the press is biased. And I said, quit arguing about it, assume it, do your plan to be elected, assuming that the press is not going to be with you. And I think maybe it's just moved even more so after this last campaign.
30 seconds.
30 seconds. I certainly want the press to continue to have access, the traditional media as well, in a Trump administration, and I think we will all fight to make that happen and try to be tough and fair.
Chris.
There's certainly more noise now than there's ever been, and I call about social media, and but people seem to find their way to the truth. In fact, the numbers, the audiences are astronomical. I mean, they've never been bigger. People are drinking the news, the hard news, not the opinion of Fox News, out of a fire hose. And our job, I feel my job is exactly what it's always been, be the cop on the beat, keep them honest, check the facts, tell the truth. And I think there may be certain fascination right now with certain phenomena, but people will find their way back to core values.
Good.
The clock tells me that we're quickly running out of time. So my thanks first to our wonderful attentive audience here at the National Press Club and all over the world. And super thanks to our two terrific moderators and the co-chairs of the Commission on Presidential Debates. I leave you with a thought from Winston Churchill. Democracy, he pointed out, is the worst form of government, except for all the others. Anyway, that's it for now. I'm Marvin Kalb, as Ed Morrow used to say many, many years ago, good night and good luck.
He just asked me what Cronkite signed off of. That's the way it is.
That's the way it is.
We hit our 30-second mark.
Now, what happens now is that we have about 15 minutes, and we are very happy to take your questions. And there are microphones on either side. Hello there, back there, and back here. So stand up, go to the microphone, ask a question, and please identify yourself and ask a question, because if you don't, I'll cut you off. Mean that I am. Over there in the darkness, could I see somebody? Hello?
Hi, I'm Francisco Alvarez from Central Florida. My question is, I read an article about how a failure of this last round of, in this last election season is that we didn't focus enough on policy, that we focused on personality. But when I go back and look at the debates, I think there are a lot of solid questions about policy, but candidates answer questions the way they want to answer them. And they realize that a lot of people don't want to have a very detailed discussion of tax policy. So what is your reaction to that? Do you think that we focused enough on policy and that politicians just answered the way they wanted to, or there wasn't enough of a focus on policy?
Did you address that to any one of the four panelists?
I think Raddatz and Wallace.
Okay.
Yeah.
The moderators.
Okay, Raddatz and Wallace, let's go.
Yep. An anchor team for the 21st century.
Yes, I mean, we definitely want to talk about policy, and you definitely want to guide it back to the policy questions when you're in the middle of a debate, and it doesn't always work. Actually, exactly what you said is what happens. They're going to answer it and take it in direction they want to do it. You try to steer them back to the policy. I do think this was a pretty personality-driven campaign, without question. I know we try to move to the issues and that we try to, not just in the debates, but in our general news coverage as well, to talk about the issues, but it doesn't always work.
Yeah, the only thing I would add, and I agree with that completely about the debates, in terms of news coverage, we do talk about the issues, but I will say, and this is nothing new, this has been true as long as I've been in journalism, which is that the horse race is always fascinating, and who's up and who's down, and it isn't especially enlightening, but you can't ignore it, and if a candidate is, you know, either soaring or sputtering, that's part of the story too. But we really do try our best to get to the issues, particularly in the debates, and as Martha says, sometimes they answer and sometimes they don't, and we don't have power to a limited degree we do, as I say, when I was asking Hillary Clinton about pay to play as an issue, but to a certain degree they're gonna do what they wanna do.
Thank you, very much. Over here to the right, please.
Hello, my name is Yaman Kaskin. I entered into the United States back when it used to be legal as an immigrant in 1980. My understanding of journalism is embedded in me by movies like All the President's Men, which is why I appreciate being here tonight and appreciate being in the presence of two great journalists. So my question is to you, Chris, and to you, Martha. We all have regrets as humans, as 50% of our country does today. If you could rewind the tape and go back to the last debate, what question would you have asked the candidates that you wish you had asked?
Climate change.
poverty, homelessness. All right, can I say something? And I probably shouldn't do this, but here's where I would disagree with you, Mike, on this, because I thought about it, and I was getting a lot of, you get a lot of emails of people suggesting questions. It's not just they're writing to you, they're also writing to us. I thought there were a lot of big issues that hadn't been discussed in depth that I wanted to ask. I did think about climate change. There are some subjects, and I know a lot of you aren't going to like what I'm going to say. I'm not saying that the issue isn't important, but I'm not sure that climate change is the best 15-minute debate topic. I think it gets technical fast. It gets technical fast or it gets general fast, as opposed to things like, what are you going to do about entitlements? Where are you on deportation or sanctuary cities? Those are clear, obvious topics. It's a little, I think climate change can be a little bit like grasping at clouds, and it's a hard 50, I've thought about it a lot as a topic, but it's not an easy 15-minute topic.
Okay.
You know, but that goes back to what the challenge is to you, is to kind of figure out how do you take a difficult subject like that and draw out of the candidate something that gives us some sense of what's going to happen if they get elected. And we didn't, now in retrospect, I think back to the debates, I'm not sure that we drew out of either Secretary Clinton or Mr. Trump enough information about what would you really do if you're going to be in office. And I fully appreciate that getting that substantive is very, very hard to do, but we're now in the post-campaign, post-election time, now we have to deal with the reality that one of those elected is governing. And we are shocked every day that we are surprised by all the corrupt, stuff that's being suggested. And maybe if we had used the debates to elicit more of that, that would be more helpful to us where we are right
okay.
now. That's my point.
But
come on.
Okay.
We're going.
All right.
Next question, please.
Hi, I'm Holly Goldberg from South Florida, and I'm a journalism student of Mike Friedman's. I have a question for Chris. You said that the journalist's role is to follow public opinion and not lead public opinion. But journalism is they're kind of responsible for being the agenda setters. So how do you differentiate following the public opinion and leading the public opinion and having to consider your viewership and getting views and, you know, how leaving Donald Trump's mic on to get more views, how do you balance leading public opinion and following public opinion?
Well, I guess I brought that up. I just want to make it clear to anybody that has any doubts. I was saying that that was a bad thing that we did, where I was speaking also to the issue that some people say we were favoring Donald Trump or building Donald Trump up. I think we're just, because if you put him on TV, people liked it, which I thought was an irresponsible decision. I don't know that we're supposed to do anything about, we're not supposed to shape public opinion one way or the other. We're supposed to report the news and let people decide for themselves what they think. And, you know, it's not our, we're not there to shape or to follow or anything public opinion. We're there to report the news. People can make up their own minds.
No, miss, hold on. We got a lot of questions. Got to go to other people. Over here, please.
Hi, my name is Rachel Oswald. I'm a reporter with CQ Roll Call. This question is for the panel, including you, Marvin. It's about the relevancy, actually, of the presidential debates. I'm saying that as someone who really, really wants them to be relevant. But as you said earlier tonight, we had 100 million people tuning into the first presidential debate. Myself and I think many of the other people in their analysis of the debate thought that Clinton overall won the debates, came off as more presidential, had more control of herself and the policy and her temperament. But then Donald Trump won the Electoral College. And if there
what is your question?
My question is, given that you had 100 million people watching and one candidate was seen as doing stronger in the debates, what does that mean that the candidate who is seen as being the weaker debater won the election? What does that mean for the debate's ability to influence the voters? Or are we in a Washington bubble, us journalists who are watching the debates and saying this person did better, and we have fundamentally different takeaways?
Okay. Frank.
You are in a bubble. The bubble, there are three bubbles in this country, and there are echo chambers. One starts on the east coast of Boston, comes down through Hartford, goes to New York, goes down from Wilmington, Philadelphia, Baltimore, and Washington. It goes up, and it's the New York Times, Washington Post bubble. Then you go out to Seattle, and you come down from Seattle to Portland to San Francisco, L.A., and that's the L.A. Times, San Francisco Chronicle bubble, and then you've got a small bubble around the Great Lakes. If you look at the map where the red is and where the blue is, you'll see that's what happened. And what happened was that bubble around the Great Lakes broke this time. He broke that blue bubble there. Your determination as to who won the debate depends on what you were looking for. The point I made before is that the American people, in having done 30 of them, aren't necessarily looking for the smartest candidate. They're gaining something out of it. He was talking to someone totally different than you, and they voted for him.
Marvin, here's a great statistic that comes out. In average, 10% of the American people have a postgraduate degree or post-undergraduate degree or graduate degree of some sort. Hillary Clinton won all 18 states in where people have above that 10% average, all the states in which people have more higher degree, you know, more likely to have a graduate degree, and only won three of those below 10%. So Frank's argument is the smart people voted for Clinton.
Hold it.
And the smart people aren't always right. Like,
yeah. Let that sit. You got another question here?
Hi. Another question? Hi, Sam Hussein. I live in Riverdale, Maryland. I hope this doesn't degenerate into a technical global warming type question, but I do have a very specific question about something that Mike McCurry alluded to, and that's the 15% exclusion criteria. This isn't a nonpartisan group. This is a bipartisan group that you're both former...
It's a nonpartisan group. You're wrong, sir.
You're both Democrats or Republicans, and so
not
on.
Not everyone on the commission is, sir. I'm just going to correct you with
this. It's always been headed by the former heads or prominent officials of either the Democrat or Republican Party. It was founded by the Democratic and Republican
correct.
Parties. You
What's
and
your
Paul
question?
Kirk.
So I'll be
my, my question is a very specific one, and I hope that I can actually say it. It's your criteria is 15% in the quote-unquote major polls. when some people came forward and said, let's set up another criteria that, for example, if 50% of the American people wanted somebody else to be on, then they should be included as well. And the then heads of the commission, or actually it was Paul Kirk and Alan Simpson, who was on the board, said that's a ridiculous criteria. The only question that matters is who you want to be president. There's a problem here. And the problem is that no poll asks the American public who they want to be president.
Sir,
it's a very specific question, and it's a very legitimate question.
You've asked your question.
No, I haven't.
We'll ask you. Go ahead.
No poll is asking the American public who they want to be president. Every poll asks.
Ask
what's
your
the question?
Yeah.
Every poll asked, if the election were held today, who would you vote for? That's a different question. And it would result.
Is that the question you're asking?
Why aren't you abiding by your own criteria?
We are. And we've been sued in every election cycle other than 2008 with the question of what the criteria is and whether or not we're following the standards that the commission was set up with. Now, I must be candid with you. We constantly look at the criteria between every single series of debates to determine. There's some on the commission who thinks it should be higher. Some thinks it should be lower. Others think and have volunteered that everybody who's on enough ballots to conceivably get 270 electorates ought to be included. We go through it every time. We decided to go with the League of Women Voters, who in 1980 adopted the 15% rule. That was a debate most people forget, where the President of the United States refused to participate because someone who was above 15, John Anderson, was invited to participate. So the question of what the criteria should be, we get input every 4 years, we look at it hard, we did it again this time, and decided that the 15% rule established by the League of Women Voters was one that we should stick
with. And let me add one thing to that. If ever there were an election where we had two major party-nominated candidates that were not regarded favorably by a majority of Americans, where there was an opportunity for a third-party independent candidate to actually inspire people, get support, get above 15%, this was the election. The fact is that neither Governor Gary Johnson nor Dr. Jill Stein generated that kind of enthusiasm. So the problem wasn't our problem, it was their problem.
Okay, thank you both. That was very interesting. Next question, please.
Hi, my name is Jonathan Hellman. I am formerly with CNN and MSNBC. This question is for Ms. Raddatz and Mr. Wallace. You spoke about some of the great reporting that was done during this campaign season, New York Times, Washington Post, and others, and I agree with you. However, it was found that the majority of stories that were shared, the stories that were shared the most, came from these more alternative sources of news that turned to be, fake news from these fringe sites. Yeah. I'm curious to see your thoughts on what you think led to this growth of, it seems, acceptance that the people have had in these kind of stories. Because as we saw, obviously, in this past weekend, what it turned out at one of the pizzerias here in D.C. So I'm curious what your thoughts are on the acceptance of this.
Okay.
Well, junk sells, and it always has. I'm sure there were times when the circulation nationally for the National Enquirer was greater than the New York Times. It's challenging for the democracy, but it doesn't change our job as journalists, which is to do the best reporting, the most honest reporting we can, and as I say, there's going to be more noise out there, and the world is changing. People were saying to me, quoted an article in the New York Times about whether or not we should be reporting Donald Trump's tweets, and my reaction is, if it's newsworthy, absolutely. I talked about when I was in 1980, when I was covering, or 82, when I was covering Reagan, and he'd go out to the helicopter, and people'd shout a question, and he'd give a quick answer, But some of the times he was giving an answer, and it was off the cuff, but it was interesting, it was news, and we reported it.
He might be tweeting all the time if he were president. You never know.
He probably would.
Bill Clinton used to give answers coming back from McDonald's after his morning jog, and we stopped him from doing that.
Quickly, there's just more social media. It's just spreading and spreading and spreading, and nothing's stopping it. And people need to sit back and figure out that this is fake news. A lot of it is out there. I don't know how they do that, but.
Well, I think we've run out of time again. I want to thank you guys very, very much. It has been great fun. Great fun. And thank you all for being with us. Thank you very, very much. You did very well, Dan. You're very good at this stuff.